Alright. Huh, this camera's a little bit angled down now, isn't it? There we go. I actually moved this last night. Move the monitor a little bit closer to me, move some stuff. Alright, cool. You don't need any of that. I'm gonna play some Turf War. What's going on? What's going on, Ross? How you doing? You have a question. What's the question? Animal in my room. Hello, Rudy. What's up, man? Moray. Ew, gross. You've been typing for a while, Ross. What's this question? What does it entail? Moray was in a Splatfest, and I actually was, like, digging. Turf War. Splatfest did make me like Turf War. One burst bomb and another direct plus indirect is two subs of damage. Two subs of damage will do it. Just two subs of damage. Two subs of damage is one of like the magical burst bomb numbers. There's a couple different ones for a couple different weapons. Two subs is the one for vanilla splatter shot and a few others. It's good for carbon. It's pretty much good for any burst bomb weapon, but it's really good for splatter shot and slasher specifically. Kind of funny because there used to be like two arguable numbers for splatter shot, but when they changed burst bombs, they upped the damage of the lightest hitbox, and that made it so the other it was a main and a sub of damage. Now that value is kind of obsolete; it doesn't really do anything special anymore. I mean, obviously, if you start thinking about defense and such, and weapons that your teammates have. It's gonna get a little bit different, but oh my god! But generally speaking, Splattershot needs abilities, like needs abilities, so you just run the two subs of damage, and if someone has to, if you have to worry about defense, you just kind of let people sit in your ink on the ground. As opposed to try to run more damage to do something about it, because pretty much if someone's going to run defense, you will not be able to afford enough damage to do something about it with Splattershot. It just doesn't work out, so you therefore play differently to deal with defense instead of build differently. There we go. Makes me kind of want to play Splattershot. Camp is in rotation. It's pretty nice. I'm gonna close my door. If it's open, I can hear the news from the other room. Alright. What's going on, Lava Leaf? I almost called you Lava Reef. Lava Reef. Lava Reef. It's a good, a good song. The theme for Lava Reef Zone from Sonic 3 is good. Alright, let's get the good old. Actually, let's use a little bit of ink recovery here. There we go. First one in a while, yeah. That's fine. Streamed a scrim last night, although it didn't go too well. We had a sub and we just didn't like have a lot of synergy. It's whatever. But it's cool because we're kind of getting a little bit more fine-tuned about like our scheduling and scrims and stuff. So hopefully we won't have to like just bar random subs, and that's funny. We got two hero weapons on the team. I would know that kind of stuff if Mario actually did it, Cap. How about no? Oh shit. What is that? That's a jet. Too much to talk about right now, unfortunately. And I guess something worth mentioning is that the Academy server, I went ahead and made the tournament discussion public for everyone because we had this like open requirement for it, because we were trying to find some a little bit more for voiced people in the server to be able to do, but more or less turns out that if you make a voice requirement to talk about tournaments and some people in the tournament aren't voiced, it's kind of dumb that they can't talk about the tournament that they played in and potentially even won. That's a funny kit. So we remove that requirement. And I'd like to try to find a way to entice people, like, after a tournament for, like, the top teams to come and talk about it. Like, if you can get that to be the culture, that'd be really cool, because then the tournament discussion could be, pretty significant. To get him. I feel like going back to Zimmy. Everybody has the same shoes on my team. That's funny. Dynamo was kind of tryharding at being up at open or being up at Overlook. Talkie, all right, so let's switch back to Zimmy here. And hope we get camp, or in the case of a Nintendo game, please don't get camp. Camp would be terrible. I just don't want it. Do I do it work? I mean, I rush off to work because I have work. I work at public relations at my school. I also work at the Holocaust Resource Center at my school. Yeah, what's going on, Orange? And that entails public relations. I work on the website, so I do like HTML, CSS, that kind of stuff. Ouch. And at the Holocaust Center, that job just changes all the time, really. One week there could be some kind of event that we're getting ready for. One week I could work on the website. One week we could be like driving somewhere to do something. The Holocaust Center at my school is like really active. Does a lot of stuff. And I'm just kind of like, whatever happens to need to be done at that point is what I end up doing. That's not the best answer, but it varies a lot. We work with a lot of local Holocaust survivors and stuff like that too. This guy, screw this guy. You know. Stop looking at me. Now I have bubble I can flank. Ah. I should get coffee because I am tired right now. So I'm gonna drink too much coffee today, and I know I'm gonna get more at work later, but I'm gonna screw it. The risk of someone just getting behind me. This. Oh, okay, that was weird. I went to Kamikana College for a while, that's cool. Oh, the gate's down. Yay, finally. That's the one thing about this map that sucks at Turf War is the gate mechanic. You don't have access to most of the map to the last minute. Oh, okay. Yeah, game can be pretty tough. I mean, it's also natural since like it's a game that's been out for a while. Games that have been out for a while tend to have people that are just really good at them. Yeah, we definitely lost there. Kind of feel like going just like a movement speed 10 attack or something. Because you're watching. I'll show a bit about like movement and stuff. Like the way you have to move in this game is you have to like constantly go between swimming and not swimming, and it just like makes your strafe crazy. So let's try that. I'm gonna go wasabi instead of 10 attack because I like wasabi more. Actually, no, we'll go 10 attack. Actually, yeah, fuck it, we'll go wasabi. I don't know if you've seen wasabi before. Right. It was like one of my mixed shirts. I'm just like never wearing my mixed shirts anymore. Yeah, this one's nice, I like this shirt. And then we'll go with the swim speed shoes. And this lets you go real fast. The long blue gun? Oh, the custom jet? Yeah, custom jet's really strong. That's one of the... I'd say that's high tier. It's a little bit outclassed by custom range blaster, but it's still really, really good and does slightly different things and has more range. Frank likes the red one because he says it looks like a brute plasma rifle. Unfortunately, that one's not too good. The custom jet with the blue rain. So there's a vanilla jet and a custom jet. The vanilla one has wall ink strike. The custom jet has burst bomb kraken. The burst bomb kraken one's the good one. It's because it's a light depletion kraken weapon. So when you die, you don't use as much meter, and people put some special saver on it, and then some other stuff that kind of makes the gun a little bit better. And the end result is. End result is it's just like really reliable, puts up a lot of pressure, has Kraken when it needs it, There's some weapons that try to spam Kraken a lot. Custom Jet's one of the few that just like holds on to Kraken and uses it at the perfect time. So you can die, it's okay. So Kraken. This guy. Ooh, that was a carbon fire. That was dumb. Where's Kraken at? Hello. Solid aim. Ah. Yeah, I am playing sluggish this morning, but it's tight. Let's not be here. Oh, okay. Oh. Oh god. Ah. That game was a little weird. We won, so that's good, right? Junior, though. Kind of maybe want to put on Ink Resist. Let's change it up slightly. I'll go 10 attack this time because I didn't use Ink Strike at all. So. Oh, this is the same thing as 10 attack, by the way. This is like a skin that you get for leveling up. It's the same exact thing as 10 attack. I'm going to keep that. Meanwhile, FLC is like, you're not wearing damage. Oh god, what is Frank? Frank posting funny stuff. In my Discord. Frank's the best. Ugh. I'll wake up a little bit here. You know, for a while, this was the 10 attack that you ran, just all movement speed, nothing else. There's like no reason to run anything else, no one had good gear anyway. You could just literally do whatever you wanted. We're going this way? Alright, let's go this way then. It's just funny how the game's changed since then. You never see, like, all movement speed 10 attack anymore. Oh god, there's another person there. There was always an ink efficiency craze where people would just be like, main save, sub save, or not sub save, sub save was bad back in the day, but people would use main save and ink recovery on everything. And sometimes it was like a little bit weird. I was like, why would you ever run main save on a 10 attack? Like, maybe if there's some kind of weird after a section bomb thing that you're going for, but it's just really hard for me to see the value in putting main save on a 10 attack, but everybody wanted to do it. Because they still had this like Terraform mentality of just like, we gotta paint. Like, you don't need main save to be able to paint efficiently. Where are they? Is there one behind us? I don't think so. This guy's strange. Smart yet? Oh, okay. I thought that was not our sniper. Nice grenade. I miss all that. How did I do that? The best weapon with 7 special? I mean, well, I think E-Leader. Just the vanilla E-Leader is probably just the best weapon in the game, but I know some people don't agree with me, but that's what I think. I feel like going Neosplash. Yeah, we're going Neosplash. Neo's actually not a bad weapon for this. I like it at all. It's pretty good on Moray. It's pretty good on camp. But no, I think Vanilla E-Leader is just the best gun in the game. When someone is truly good and they're using an E-Leader, they lock down a ton of map control. They get echoes, they kill everything, they control space. It's like, I know that right now the Japanese meta has been kind of in this direction of map control being like the best thing ever, and you know, sometimes they'll run like Nose Charger on certain maps, or they'll try to run like a Splatling instead, and map control this, map control that, but like, you don't need, every weapon doesn't have to be like a dynamo. The Squiffer's bad. The Squiffer's fun, but it's bad. If you like the Squiffer, the Splatter Scopes are better. You can run some damage on the Splatter Scope and pretty much do the same thing. Yeah, that guy also has the section symbols in his name. Squiffer, unfortunately, at a high level, it doesn't have the range to justify its charge time. So, like, if you miss once, you're gonna die. Someone's just gonna rush you, and you end up blowing your invincibility super to stay alive instead of actually using it for the team. Whereas, the Bamboozler fills a similar role, but it's way safer because it has sub-weapons that protect it instead of a special that protects it. So it can just kind of like operate normally and use its specials with the team, even though they're not quite as impactful as a Kraken or a Bubble. Cherry H3 is really hard to use, but also kind of fills the similar role, but does a better job. It too doesn't, I kill that guy. It too has a sub-weapon that protects it, so if you're all for that like one-shot kill sort of close-range thing, unfortunately there's just better options than the Squiffer. is there someone behind me? That's the real question. And I fell off the mat. I didn't fall off the mat. Okay, Junior. I don't think so. I don't have the sprinkler, but I thought I saw two of them. Yeah, but like, I think every weapon in this game has trouble when it's not in control. There are very few situations where a weapon is just like, doesn't care about not being in control. And even when you're, it does have burst bombs. I know that's not what you're talking about, but. Also like, when the E-Leader's not in control, it can still lock down an area by looking at it and still get, like, clutch kills. Like, an E-Leader that's being patient can still get out of control. And also, it gets Echo, which helps a lot for getting out of the tight spot. Aside from in tower control, where, you know, you don't get the meter when your teammate's in control, but at the same time, E-Leaders are really good at just sniping people off tower and tower control. Like, the easiest snipes you can get are against people on tower. And a well-balanced team is going to be able to have ways to get out of spawn anyway. Oh. Yeah, I just think that a well-balanced team is going to be able to get itself out of a spawn and isn't going to be, like, the E-Leader's not going to be detrimental in those cases. To the point where the team as a whole, like, all of a sudden can't get out of spawn. Oh, we were down a person. It's like, when you have a well-made team with an E-Leader, the end result is better than a team that, like, doesn't use E-Leader to avoid the problems of E-Leader and tries to, like, find something to make up for it. And it's also just kind of the, yeah, you do need to take your lack of coverage into account when you have an E-Leader, and that also is why certain weapons are good and certain weapons aren't. There's a lot of weapons that are good, but don't have a lot of coverage, and only a few of those ones actually are still good. This is because they're so good that they are able to be used besides that, like Custom Range Blaster. Custom Range Blaster is just so good that you can have a CRB and a E-Leader on the same team. And as long as you have like Zimmy or some kind of shooter that and or some kind of shooter that can paint, or whatever, you know, two weapons that can paint well, then, you can still run it just because CRB is so good. Ouch. I mean, I don't want to say never loses control, but yeah, like when you have like double Zimmy or something like that, it's really hard to lose control. But at the same time, like you can run something like that with the E-Leader. You can get the benefits of both. And all E-Leader has to do sometimes is look at someone to get them to back down for a second to allow the painting weapons to get some more painting in. This person I'm not dying for. Like, I think I've heard people say that like the basics in Japan right now try to include two really good painting weapons to each team comp, and an E-Leader doesn't really stop that from happening. And although you can make an argument that you want to lock out an E-Leader team, I think that in the end, the team that doesn't have an E-Leader versus a team that does have an E-Leader, the team with an E-Leader is never really in a bad matchup. That makes sense. Like, you can have a team that's gonna, like, be able to fight the E-Leader team back and forth, yeah, but I've never... it's hard for me to really consider a team without an E-Leader to have a good matchup versus a team with an E-Leader. A good E-Leader, mind you. Yeah, dude, CRBS is so good. I think that for my tier list, I'm gonna like remove like the god tier thing, just cause. Also, like, I think according to like classic definition, E-Leader actually isn't strong enough to be god tier anyway. I'll still probably put Vanilla Leader. What I'll probably do is put Vanilla. Put Vanilla E-Leader at like upper high tier, and just put custom E-Leader down with the others. Partially because I think just like, even though I define god tier the way I did, it's just like kind of, I'm implying that it's a little bit stronger than it is, and a lot of people do disagree with me. I think that I'll also, what was that? This game was weird. I'll also kind of do it with the caveat of like, I understand that the Japanese meta is being moved closer to map control, and that like I got my eye on it. Because over the course of this game, there's always been one good smart person at like any given time arguing how the E-Leader is actually not good, blah blah this, blah blah that, but then like the dust always settles and like the best team's always using E-Leader and the E-Leader's always winning tournaments and people who try to run no chargers just get shit on. So it's just... it'll take a little bit of convincing. Yeah, the Japanese meta isn't necessarily right either. It's just, like, I understand the logic behind why people are saying that E-Leader's starting to fall out of favor, but then again, we just had Inkstorm 3, and the best team used E-Leader, like, 80% of the time, 90% of the time, so it's hard for me to just, like, jump on the bandwagon when the teams that are winning are still using E-Leader. And if we get to a point where it's changed so much over time that, like, I'm convinced, then I'll change it. Like, I'm not, like, I'm emotionally invested in the argument. I just don't believe that if we are heading in a direction where E-Leader is not the best weapon anymore, we're not there yet. Pretty much, like... I don't know, pretty much, like, I understand why people are saying E-Leader is the best. I just want it to be proven. Like, if someone can show me, like, a bunch of Japanese tournaments where, like, good teams with E-Leaders are losing and stuff. T-Tech is on every team, which is true. I just think that a perfect player playing E-Leader has a bigger impact on the game than a perfect player playing, like, one of the foot soldier weapons, if that makes sense. Tap shot this guy? No. Yeah. I could say that about CRB. Is this the same guy from before? Might be. Bad jump, let's go. Alright. Let's go this way. And like, I put Bamboozler a little bit higher on the tier list than like maybe it's generally accepted as, because I think a really good player with Bamboozler is going to be disproportionately more effective with that weapon than someone who's really good with another weapon. Like, it's sort of like fighting games have these kind of characters where they're like super duper technical, hard to play characters that normally are only so good, but when someone gets really good with them, they kind of unlock like more potential because they got over like the high skills, they got to like the high skill ceiling. Whereas like something like a Tenatech doesn't really have the biggest skill ceiling. It kind of, you kind of like gradually get more effective as you get better, whereas like with some of these kinds of weapons, it's kind of like disproportionately strong. And I think E-Leader is like an example of that, where someone who's really good, like a godlike E-Leader player, is just going to get like disproportionately more effective. Should have jumped out earlier. Oh my gosh. ruins your coverage. Yeah, Splash isn't that much better. I mean, I think Neo Splash is really, really good. It's just that, like, Tentatech is good enough. That being said, I do think Neo Splash is... I mean, obviously I say it all the time, but I think Neo Splash is great. I think it's flexible. Neo Splash also can have more synergy with certain team comps. Like, if you have a lot of weapons that do like, single heavy hitting, like, big damage, you're kind of better off with a Splash because... with the Neo Splash because the Slayer build at least... Well, actually, all the Splash builds, for the most part, have damage, and it's just, like, there's a lot of times where you throw a burst, like, an engagement happens, and you kind of safely throw a burst bomb into it, and it just, like, gets your teammate to kill. I think that the one problem Splash has is that it doesn't deal with walls as good as Tentatech does. Like, it still does, you can still throw two burst bombs and wait, but, like, the Tentatech, if the wall goes up, you can just throw a suction bomb, and that's it, you don't really need to think about it anymore, except just not die. Whereas Neo Splash, it's more of like you kind of have to erode the wall. I think Vanilla Splash is only good on a double bomb rush team. Like, I think Vanilla Splash can be pretty decent on Urchin, for example. Because that light depletion suction bomb rush on a weapon that is, like, competent enough, combined with another bomb rush, it's kind of like on Urchin, the game kind of comes down to being able to brute force hill control. And bomb rushes do really well with that. Maybe not even double bomb rush, but if you have like another person that's like able to just get special and do something to hill, like Inkzooka suction bomb rush is pretty good. You could probably have like Tentatech Splash on a team. That'd be pretty good. Maybe even Semi Splash. Yeah, it does depend. I do think that Neo Splash is kind of well-rounded enough. Well, that person just DC'd, or he fell off the map and lagged. I do think that Neo Splash is well-rounded enough to be able to be used instead of a Tentatech if that's what you want to do, because the burst bombs in combat do give it an advantage. Play that build next. It is a little bit less able to run as many builds as Tentatech, because when you start not running damage, you need to really ask yourself if you're doing something like efficient. Oh god, what the hell's going on over here? Smack my control on the table and just be the next of my aim. I've like lost in tournaments because of that. Okay. Someone behind me? Don't care. From that the hydro charge. There we go. Very pro. Are we talking about Vanilla Splash? Yeah, I think berry splash can be good. Berry definitely, when you use it with the intent of using that bomb rush for control, it works pretty well. I think Vanilla Pro is actually equally as good. I think people undervalue Ink Strike as a means of pushing. Yeah, you definitely can't use Berry with the Elite or Custom Range Blaster. That's definitely gonna work better on different types of comps. Alrighty, I got time for one more, and then I'm gonna have to leave. Pro is just a really good main slaying weapon that has a supportive special and decent range, which works out really well because it has a good safe neutral, but it slays, like it's active. And then when it gets special, it helps out the more like close up members without having to actually be close up. Berry and CRB kind of compete for the same spot. But then again, something like a Neo Splash, I think, can be a better teammate for a Berry than a Tenetech can be, because Neo Splash can just whoop, chuck a bomb, that bomb lands, the Berry gets a one-shot, you know what I mean? Which also works for CRB. Actually works pretty well for CRB. Yeah, you can only really afford one weapon that doesn't paint well, especially, like, with an E-Leader comp, you can only afford one weapon that doesn't paint well, and that one weapon has to be doing a lot. Yeah, E-Leader, Lunar, like, yeah, that kind of stuff's done. Dumb. It only works for Chimera because they, do, like, the whole double bomb rush thing. Like, when they end up using Luna Berry, They also have Sora, so it's like double bomb rush. Double bomb rush and beacons has like a similar effect as like a quick respawn type of thing, where they just get so far up that like they have the control that way. Different method of getting control. Yeah, they do feed them. One thing that I think that people don't take advantage of about Dude is that a lot of the time, he'll get a kill when you kill his teammate. Not that he like uses teammates as bait or lets him die, but that like, I don't know, it kind of happens. It's just like, if you know that Dude is able to do something about you and you get a kill, just like don't engage Dude, like let the situation just be like a kill for you. Like, if you watch Dude, he's, like, actually pretty opportunistic. Yeah, we don't need to dive into the realm of connection quality. Alright, yeah, we got another disconnect. Well, that was a fun one. Oh, I could really use some coffee, which I will get soon. thanks for watching, guys. And yeah, I'm gonna put in a little bit more oomph into that that tier list. Change a few things around. I'm gonna kind of let it sit. Oh God, puts the stream in. Rocket stream. We'll probably host Rocket. Yeah. I think I'm gonna also keep doing the whole thing where I'm just not gonna stream comms during like scrims and stuff like that, because the way we've been running the team is just like, we don't really want to like avoid saying stuff while doing practice. Just think it's gonna keep working out like that. You're welcome. All right, well, yep, we're gonna go ahead and host Rocket, and you guys have a nice one.